Not quite so happy hell in a cell, Gabe.
Yeah. Not quite so happy hell in a cell to you as well.
Well, that just kind of ended on a dud, didn't it?
I was really looking forward to this first women's Hell in a Cell match, and I'm sorry to tell you all, sorry to tell you guys that it didn't really deliver at all. I mean, there was effort involved.
Yeah, I think.
But it was really a train wreck.
It was. It's one of the most embarrassing matches of the year. One of the most. Definitely. It's not the most. Some of the tag team matches on the pre-show back in like Money in the Bank, like when they had like a 12-team tag match, that was embarrassing. That was just a flailing of bodies, just going everywhere. By the way, aren't you excited for Survivor Series with a 5-tag team match coming up on the horizon?
Oh, great.
Wonderful idea, WWE, but regardless.
I was, I was more excited for this match than any match I think in ever.
Yeah.
To be perfectly honest, I was.
I mean, like, it looked like a great idea.
Even with Sasha Banks in it, I was excited.
And then, yeah. Okay. We're going to get to it in due time. But, first, we got to honor tradition. Yeah. Do you want to go first or shall I?
I'll go first. There you go. It's another Halloween themed gift. So.
All right.
Spooky! There's an opener.
Extreme fighting action figures. Well, you sure got lame, right? Generic wrestling action figures. We got a chainsaw. Yep. We got a spiked club.
And I think they're both luchadors there.
And we got both luchadors.
Or the Stig without his shirt on.
Yeah, but we got the white Stig and black Stig.
Yeah. But I don't know what the... You know, I've never gotten the chainsaw thing. Terry Funk or Dean
chainsaw
Ambrose,
chart.
Anybody using it, I just never got
it. Oh! Oh! This is what... Okay.
There's the piece of resistance.
Gangrel! This flowing open shirt. Is this... I'm looking at the blood stains on it, but it doesn't look like blood stains. They look like dirt stains. I remember. Is this the one? Is this the action figure you got from your aunt? Is this the exact same Gangrel action figure?
Maybe.
You're goodwilling this to me?
You're goodwilling. Where else are you gonna find it?
Oh God! Look at this face. Let's see if we can... Come on. Face. Focus.
Focus.
Focus. Come on, come on.
Focus, focus.
Focus, you piece of shit. There. Come on. I know you want to focus. Ugh. But yeah, there we are. Yeah, that's the face that says, people dare me to eat bugs and I do it. Fuck's sake, this is awful.
Yeah, isn't it great? Isn't it? It's a vampire wrestler.
Now I don't feel so bad whatsoever about giving you this. Here.
You love the game. Real.
Open it, you asshole.
The bird was awesome.
Guess what it is.
Oh, I don't need to fucking guess. It's Kevin Nash something. You already got me all his comics, so... Fucking Kevin Nash. Oh, it's Kevin Nash! Wait a surprise. Kevin Nash, Jacqueline Mudge.
It's a dick-sucking biography.
What?
It's a dick-sucking biography. It's all about how Kevin Nash is the greatest wrestler in the whole goddamn world and how dare anyone say otherwise.
Wait, this is his book?
This is a biography about him, yes. Look how fucking thin that thing.
This is the Kevin Nash biography?
Unofficial, I suppose.
No way. Okay, so I'm going to turn that around really fast so it looks normal. But yeah, there's the Kevin Nash biography and... Wow, that is thin.
Keep in mind, this was published, I think, back in 2002, I want to
say. That's like the footnotes for the biography.
Yeah, I mean, look.
Holy shit.
Yeah, I mean, like.
Like, do you have a nice day so we can compare
the
size of that to this?
Yeah, let's...
Oh my goodness, Lord.
Yeah, and this is just one of his biographies.
This is not a... This is like a children's storybook. Holy shit.
I think it was supposed to be for kids.
This is so...
But I don't know one kid that would read something.
You have to have game manuals that are larger than this.
Yeah, like this is...
Jeez.
This is Have a Nice Day.
This is Have a Nice Day. And this is like most of this is like the hardcover to it, and it is hardcover. So
and there's also an index too. So.
And there's an index. So like if we cut the hardcover out and the index,
and the table of contents.
The table of contents. Okay.
And the index.
And the chronology.
And the notes, yeah.
Okay, there we go.
Just that.
That's the Kevin Nash biography.
Can I treat you to something? Can I treat you to something really quickly? This is the level of penmanship that you're working with here. I wouldn't want to be in Razor's position now, WWF manager Jim Cornette said at the time. I always did think he was more lucky than anything else when he was champion. Now it's up to him to beat Diesel, and I don't see that happening. Michaels and Diesel were an unstoppable combination before, when Michaels was champ and Diesel was his bodyguard, and now they are again. Cornette was wrong. Just five months later, Ramon would get his revenge by beating Diesel for the Intercontinental title. But by that time, Diesel was in the middle of an 8-month-long surge that would catapult him to the top of the sport. The Diesel train had arrived, and it was unstoppable. Don't tell his hamstrings that.
Thank you, Ben.
I expect a full book report.
I'm going to get you one of these days. I'm going to get you hard.
I don't know. Like Kevin Nash has been very good to me. I don't think I'll be stopping anytime soon.
Do you want, like, an entire vault full of dog tags?
If I keep giving you Kevin Nash, it'll all be worth it. I'm giving you the gift of Nash.
Don't
drink it in, man.
Don't put Jericho anywhere near that man. You want me to hate Kevin Nash. You're determined to get me to hate him. And you know what? Maybe I'll start liking him.
Oh, no, you won't.
Maybe I'll start loving Kevin Nash so much that I'm going to start making you watch all his reruns.
You know what? I think then I would have done my job, because then I've gotten you into this... You are literally twisting yourself into this paranoid delusion that Kevin Nash is anything other than a 5-hit wonder. Year-long champion, my ass.
You can pick it up behind the couch later.
God damn it. See you when I move. The night was an eventful night.
Oh, by the way, this is what my actual abs look like, just in case you're wondering.
The night was eventful, for the most part, except for the pre-show, which has gotten pretty sterile and pretty lifeless. And, it's outside of the occasional Bookerism, which we managed to catch one.
Oh, yeah, we got a good one tonight.
Mm-hmm. When Booker T, trying to hype up the match for Survivor Series, Goldberg versus Brock Lesnar, or as he called it, Brock Lesnar versus the Beast Incarnate. Now that is a match I'd love to see. Brock Lesnar versus Brock Lesnar.
I mean, who else can get the job done?
But Brock Lesnar. You know who I'm betting on to win that fight?
The Beast Incarnate?
Brock Lesnar.
Well, I was betting on the Beast Incarnate myself.
I don't know, man. Have you seen Brock Lesnar? You know, dude's huge. I mean, he's practically the Beast Incarnate. Never change.
It's a match made in heaven.
Never change, Booker. Pre-show match, 6-man tag match featuring a bunch of vanilla midgets. Who gives a shit? Who won? Who cares? I mean, it didn't help that I tried to listen to this match while I had to do some editing.
Yeah, it's true. He had an excuse. I was watching the whole thing. I don't remember what happened.
I mean, we were. I remember once upon a time, I was so sad to hear that the cruiserweights were going to move on to Raw and not to SmackDown. Now, not so much. But then again, I think the writers behind SmackDown could book these goddamn matches better, or at the very least, make me want to care.
But in all honesty, what happened was apparently the two Sin Cara and the other luchador and I don't know, these are new guys. I don't watch Cruiserweight Classic. I watch Main Event, but I don't watch Cruiserweight Classic.
Well, apparently they're on Raw, but like
it's because I don't actually watch the network unless I'm here,
mm-hmm.
so it's, I don't see it.
Yeah. So and Hulu Raw just kind of
cuts a lot of fat out. Some of the fat, which is actually kind of juicy.
Yeah.
So kind of sometimes it's that good fat that's not too thick. Like, it kind of goes well with the rest of it.
Like Bo Dallas. The Bo Dallas segments are so weird. That's kind of, that's flavorful fat, but fat nonetheless.
Or the Dana Brooke and Bayley arm wrestling match. I mean, that's something. No.
No, no. Boy, were we wrong about what was going to be the stinker on the card. All right. But the match started off on a kind of a high note. Well, I was about to say surprising, but I feel time and time again that Rusev and Roman Reigns, though I initially thought they had no chemistry together, but then, you know,
But then they had a whole lot of matches together and kind of did what they're supposed to do and develop chemistry?
Mm-hmm. The problem I have always had with Rusev as an in-ring competitor is that his style of wrestling always seems to revolve around this idea that he's this brute force guy, and yet his finishing move is just, you know, a Steiner recliner.
Mm-hmm.
So I know accolade, camel clutch, whatever you want to call it.
Dave, if the announcers can't remember, then we can't be asked to remember.
No, I know it's the accolade. I'm not going to...
Well, the announcers don't always.
The acolyte!
When he was in NXT, they would often call it the camel clutch, even though it was already mentioned to be the accolade. So,
well,
I mean, can you blame them?
Yeah, I mean, like, I've always prescribed to the notion that if you're a monster heel, mm-hmm. which he is, then you can't abide by certain heel tactics. Because, like, submission holds are squarely within the realm of heels. Are always squarely within the realm of heels. But seeing him just kind of resort to just, like I said, like a Steiner recliner, it just feels like, you know, anyone could do that.
I mean, well, anybody can, technically.
Anyone could do that. I wanted him to do something that only a man of his size and prowess can do.
I mean, honestly, I think sometimes it's good for your back.
Don't mention to me about my backs right now, because...
I'm sorry to hear that.
No,
do you want me to give you a Steiner recliner sometime?
You know what? That would not be a half bad idea. Just not now. Okay. But outside of my little picadillos with Rusev... Him and Roman have gotten to this kind of habit of starting off slow and then working to a pretty good frothy mass. Like, his match, like his Hell in a Cell match, their Hell in a Cell match, I should say, was fairly typical of what I expect from a Hell in a Cell match. Nothing really spectacular, nothing like them trying to climb the cage for some ridiculous spot, nothing like that. I wasn't expecting them to do that. And what happened was, you know, it was just a fairly typical brutal fight. Nothing, you know, amazing about it, but, you know, for an opening match and for one that really sells the brutality, what with the Russian chain, although I wish he would do something more interesting, Rusev would do something more interesting with the Russian with the chain, other than, like, bridle Roman Reigns like he's riding Pegasus.
What, you mean his finisher?
Yeah, he's just doing his finisher, yeah. you know, like, the chain in the mouth, all right, it's a nice visual, but it really doesn't add anything.
Oh, and how about that? It didn't get the job done. Like, the accolade, like, if you're not able to reach the ropes, and, of course, it doesn't matter in a no disqualification match, but normally that's like a game ender.
Yeah,
if you're not able to somehow.
So, like, there's always this, like, Rusev tips whenever he's, you know, put somebody in the acolyte, but he's not acolyte. I call it acolyte.
It's all right. There was a tag.
He always gives a tip when somebody is supposed to get out of the accolade. He bridges him by his nose instead of by his chin.
It's a tell.
Yeah, it's always
very telling.
It's always a tell. Like when he won the U.S. title off of Kalisto, but. By the way, what a fucking flash of the pan Kalisto wound up being.
Yeah. You know, I still haven't seen that terrible promo he apparently cut.
Yeah.
Was it a couple months ago?
Oh, yeah, back when the draft happened. So
yeah, I haven't seen that yet. I think I just didn't want to.
Yeah. Like, I mean, if he wasn't buried when Rusev got it, he certainly buried himself that night.
Speaking of bad promos, mentioning from Raw, Paul Heyman, what the fuck? What happened? I mean, like, I understand that the crowd was on Lesnar's side, but that shouldn't have tripped him up that much. He's Paul Heyman. He's been so fucking good in the past. I've never seen him err like this.
He was stuck in a rock and a hard place. Mm-hmm. He had to believe. He was told specifically that to get the crowd against Brock Lesnar. So he had to pretend that the crowd was against him. But, you know, when you're in Minneapolis, Minnesota, which is closest to Brock Lesnar's hometown as you're ever going to get, they're not going to boo him.
No.
They're not going to boo
him. Quite an oversight.
And so, you know,
for the booking.
So fucking Heyman, just like, for the first time I've ever seen him, deer in headlights. And that poor, poor man.
And that's just, you know, it happens to everyone.
Yeah.
I know he's, I think he's gotten hit pretty hard for what he did, but it happens, man. It happens.
Yep.
Happens to the best.
Happens to the best. WWE should have taken that into account and not just fed him to the sharks, as it were.
Even mouthpieces have, you know, botches.
Yeah. But let's get to the match itself. As far as spots are concerned, it began pretty slow, but as it picked up towards the middle, and finally with a nice crescendo with a spear off the steel steps, so like what amounts to an elevated spear, which was a nice little tasty treat.
That was interesting for me. The Russian chain
mm-hmm.
on the steps with the Acolyte wasn't enough to finish him off. I mean, I know it wasn't here. It was kind of here, so it was like, it could go either way, but
mm-hmm.
but the spear, the elevated spear off the steps was enough.
Yeah. Well, after a 25-minute, you know, beatdown.
Yeah.
I mean, like,
I don't know.
He landed a Superman punch. I mean, come on.
Oh, he did it with the chain, too, right?
No.
Oh, he didn't even...
Rusev had the chain. Roman never touched the chain.
That's right. He never even touched the chain. So, mm-hmm. I mean, maybe a super punch with the chain would have helped, but...
Yeah.
Honestly, just no super punch would help.
Yeah. And once again, we must mention the fact that Roman is the wrestler who makes it the hardest to like him. And it's all because of that goddamn vest.
The fucking vest that he keeps...
He keeps wearing. Like, we're supposed to believe that him being whacked with a kendo stick across the chest is supposed to hurt when he's wearing a big padded fucking vest.
It's why do people keep aiming for that vest? I know why they do. It's because it's an easy target. It's easy to not hurt him and make it look like he's getting hurt. But the truth is he's not, because he has a fucking vest on and we can all see that.
Like, I mean, I agree with everyone that he looks better with the vest on than without. I've seen him.
Oh, yeah, he's like a way better looking Bull Buchanan.
Come on, that's giving him way too few credit. But
Bull Buchanan or him?
I'll leave it up to you. But my point is that it's both helping him and hurting him at the exact same time, and I can't really think of a good situation for it. Like Rusev whaps out the kendo sticks and like, hey, it's been a few months since I've seen a nice tasty kendo stick spot. I want to see some right punishment. And sure enough, Roman lays into Rusev, takes it across the chest like a man, takes it and just sells it like the stinging pain it is. And then when it's Roman's turn, like on one hand, if you're Rusev, why not aim for the arms?
Yeah.
But then you have this, like, you're fighting with yourself with this internal logic of, well, if you aim for the arms, it's not as vital as the chest. Well, you can't aim for the chest anyway, because it's got this goddamn...
How about taking the leg out, hamstring him with it?
Or something.
Like, use it as, like, to sweep him off, you know, from under his legs. Or sweep him out.
Yeah, that's a nice, you know, it also would show off Roman's athleticism to properly sell being a toe hold.
Yeah.
Or, well, if it's from behind, it's not
really...
It's
just a sweep with the frickin' stick. It could work. It fucking works. It really does.
Trust us. We've done it. It
hit them right in the, you know, back of the knee. Mm. Takes a guy out. I mean, it looks cool, too. It's theatrical. But, no, seriously, though, Roman Reigns is a great wrestler. Not the best, but he's good. He's solid.
He's a good, solid wrestler.
Yeah, he doesn't have, you know, he has very few botches. He's cheated by a shitty moveset. But the problem is he's got that eternal smugness, that smug look on his face. That like, doesn't help him.
He has resting heel face.
Yeah, he has resting heel face, and he's only okay on the mic. Used to be not good on the mic, but he's gotten better.
I mean,
he needs to heel turn.
He needs heel turn, but I don't know. Like at this point, I think he gets more heel heat by pretending that he's a tweener or ice.
No, that's the truth. So, but I think the idea here is to get people to like him somehow.
Well, his work rate wins people over at the end of the day. I mean, like, when he's in the mid-card right now, top of the mid-card, granted, but mid-card nonetheless, he is way more watchable, and usually his matches are booked all right. Like, yeah. For the most part, they are. I mean, I can't imagine where this can go outside of, you know, when Roman retains as a U.S. champion. Is U.S. Championship. I can't imagine that there's really much traction for the two anymore. So I'm wondering where Rusev is going to go from there.
Yeah, I've never really liked the feud between them.
They work well together. What they wind up working well together, but the whole build, like
the story isn't good enough. It's
yeah, like it just makes Roman to be a bully. Bully.
It
rather.
Really does. It does. It's like a throwback to you know, the '90s. To the, I mean, normally that's a good thing in my book. It's to go back to Attitude Era is a good thing, but somehow the story is a little out of place.
Yeah. That,
It's like it has the kind of the old fashioned feel to it without the good parts of it, the merit of that time. Like the whole Lana thing with the cake, it was just like, that was getting a little bit corny for me. It was a little much.
Yeah, I mean. It's especially if they're gonna try to sell him as the more face side of tweener than heel side.
Yeah.
Which I don't know. Like one of these days they're gonna pull the trigger and it's gonna be glorious. Same thing with Seth Rollins. When they're gonna pull that face trigger, it's gonna be great.
Arguably, he's already. Well, not even arguably. He's technically face in the match he's in tonight, and
that's the de facto face. But like, he hasn't gotten that actual like
for the purpose of the match he's face.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I think it's better to keep selling him as a proper heel time and time again until that turn. Though this lead up or middle ground, I don't think that does the turn any good.
No, you need Triple H. One of these days, Triple H is going to come around and. And then he's going to cement him as a face. And, you know, fabulous day. Other little interesting factoids we notice. Kevin, I know you're watching this, Kevin. But tell your cameramen to not linger on shots of your performers if they're within distance of the convenient little holes that you cut into the chain link fence for climbing spots. Kind of ruins the effect, you know what I mean?
Yeah, that was a bad angle.
Yeah. Guess where Gabe's mutton chops went? Right under Rusev's face.
I was wondering where they went, and then I found them. I he's wearing them well, I think. Yeah. But not quite as good as me, I suppose. But
oh, no one can wear the mutton chops like you. No one. We should not gloss over this at all, because even though the spear, the elevated spear, was the, you know, the nice Christmas cracker at the end of the night, what actually set it up properly was that Roman managed to get Rusev onto his shoulders and from a squatting position lift him up for a Samoan drop right under the steel steps, making it easily the best Samoan drop I've ever seen. Which, you know, think about the competition for that title. But it's Roman is a lot stronger than people give him credit for, I believe.
Oh, he's... I don't know. I think people give him a pretty good amount of credit, because that's kind of what he relies on, is his strength. His ability to pick somebody up for a power... Just, you know, deadlift them from the, armbar or whatever into a power bomb is really awesome.
But when he's doing that to Seth Rollins, it's not the exact same as having Rusev on your shoulders and then...
Yeah.
Basically doing a squat thrust.
Yeah. I mean, it's like near Cena levels of brute strength.
Yeah.
Although we have yet, I think, to see him just stack people on top of him like pancakes. And
then see... Yeah.
Just dump them over.
WrestleMania 22. Yeah. Jesus fuck. Talk about it. That is an underrated WrestleMania. Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of shit in WrestleMania 22, but it has the best Mick Foley match, I believe. It has a great Shawn Michaels street fight match. Yeah, that was Shawn Michaels street fight with Vince McMahon, where he just wallops him for like 20 solid minutes.
Yeah, that definitely rivaled Austin's feuds with Vince. That was really good.
Oh, yeah. That was like, that was perfection.
Yeah, good on Vince for
taking that beating. Oof.
Yeah.
Well, good on Sean for
for delivering that beating. I'm sure it wasn't a problem for him at all.
Hey, he's a good company man. Outside of his insistence on wanting to go to WCW back in 1996, but you know, water under the bridge.
Ah, it's Shawn Michaels. I'll
yeah,
forgive him for anything.
Yeah, it's, you know, you make Vader cry. You know, whatever. No big whoop. No big whoopsie. No big whoop. Last, anything left? Not really. It was a perfect way as far as getting the crowd into the night. Did its job. I'm not too upset about the booking decision. Mm-hmm. Not too big. It does leave me wondering where both are going to go. So, and I guess, you know, at the end of the day, that's what you want for both. Next match, probably the heartbreaker for you. Until the final match, but we were prepared for it to being the worst of the night, and unfortunately, it's a Bayley match, but not... Unfortunately, it's a Bayley match, but not surprisingly, it's a Dana Brooke match. Can Dana Brooke...
Okay, so I'll be the first to admit...
go ahead, just...
I know I hitch my wagon to the worst people ever.
Not... I made an offhand comment during the match where it's like, I made an offhand comment that, like, you tend to hitch your wagon to the wrong horses sometimes.
And, yeah, you know, I'll say this. Yeah, I do. I kind of do.
Yeah.
I mean, I understand.
Like, you like who you like, and that's, you shouldn't feel bad for that, but...
Well, you know, I've always been a bit of a hipster in the way I tend to like certain people that others don't.
Yeah,
but... But, you know, a certain person.
Certain person with a bad attitude.
Hindsight is 20/20. Not so much Ryback, though.
Oh, no, you're talking about somebody else, are you? Oh, you're talking... Oh, I know who you're talking about. Somebody else who liked to do a flying headbutt a little too often, one might say.
Yes, the word... He we shall not name...
I think you all know who we're talking
about. I have a bad record.
Well, don't feel so bad about it, because a lot of people got behind him.
Yeah.
I mean, like,
he was very technically proficient. He was a great wrestler.
Oh, yeah. Like, nobody could take...
Great work ethic, if a little bit psycho. And, he's like, don't eat your fried chicken over his gym bag, because apparently he'll snap.
Well, apparently the story goes that they were looking for an excuse to be angry at The Miz. And so they just looked at that one little incident and decided, that's our only window. And so we're just going to blow this out of proportion. Yeah. So it was just like this mounting heat that he got just because he was on the real world.
Yeah. But, so my latest pet project apparently is Dana Brooke.
I mean, like, it's not like she doesn't have potential. Like, she has some great spots, but God damn it, does she... Is it just me, or does it seem like women's wrestling these days, as good as it is, always seems to revolve around the notion of going around the block to just go next door? You know what I mean? Like, here's Dana Brooke doing a handstand just to put her foot against somebody's neck. Why not just, you know, do what Kevin Nash used to do and just put your foot against that guy's neck?
Yeah.
I mean, like, yeah, it's nice seeing that, but it's so...
It's a bit of a throwback to some of the diva moves back when they would have a lot of use your legs in matches and do ridiculous cartwheels and.
I mean, it's athletic as all
hell. Handsprings into the bump, you know. But
yeah. Yeah, like it's, you know, it goes back to China, you know, winning that match. Well, actually, it goes back to China doing that whole like cartwheel into a backflip, handspring, and then just doing what amounts to just like a back press.
Yeah,
it's going to, that looks,
or what is now I guess a rear view kind of
thing. A reverse modified bear blaster. But like it looks all right, athletic as all hell during the lead up.
I mean, it's like, but women are able to do certain things that men aren't quite as good at in that way, of like gymnastics.
Well, not without being a cruiserweight.
More fit. Well, yeah, but I mean, if you watch, you know, female gymnastics, you can see that there's a level of finesse that you can't reach with men. Not quite.
Not usually, but if we're, but my point is that going around the block just to show off athletic display better. And with something that looks brutal, or at the very least, looks like it has impact. And all the times, it's just what amounts to Dana Brooke just putting her foot against her neck.
Okay, so something that I've noticed is that Dana Brooke, she's kind of short. She doesn't have very long legs, I think might be part of the problem.
Mm-hmm.
And she constantly is using them. Case in point being the,
mm-hmm.
The botched finish on Bailey.
Where her legs weren't long enough to use the ropes to get the dirty pin.
I think that was the problem. She was supposed to get, you know, she was supposed to get a dirty pin over Bailey and, you know, win the heel way. But she wasn't able to get her little legs up there on the ropes. I mean, so she got clean over.
Yeah.
Man, that was embarrassing to watch. I felt terrible for her. And Bailey.
Yeah.
I felt terrible.
Like, Dana, you know, buried Bailey quite a bit that night.
That was, that was really harsh.
That was just, that was tough to swallow. For both people,
I wasn't sure. I thought they might terminate her contract right there, but.
Nah, I don't think there would be that. They would.
Or, well, you know, give her Moppy. Seriously.
Harry Saturn her?
Yeah. I was just, that was pretty bad. And then, again tonight, she tried to do a move where she does like a handstand into a choke with the leg. And it's like it connected, but it looked really weak.
Yeah.
And it wasn't really working. So, other than that, it wasn't terrible. She was still a little bit sluggish on certain roll-ups and stuff, but...
Yeah.
There's something that I did a little research on Dana Brooke. Actual research on Dana Brooke, and she's got about her actual wrestling career is 3 years long. That's not even her wrestling career. She started training exactly like around 3 years ago.
I think she'll be a good talent one day.
Yeah, her first fucking training day was 3 years ago. That is really green. She shouldn't even, like, it's arguable that she shouldn't even have been in NXT yet.
Like, you go down to, what was it, Florida Championship, FCW, FEC, or something like that. Like, they have another developmental territory down in Florida they don't broadcast their nationally syndicated, well, not nationally syndicated, but they don't get network time. But yeah, like she belongs there, arguably, and then working through NXT and then through that. But apparently she, you know, she has the look that, you know, got her where she is. But unfortunately, like she has talent, she has look, she just doesn't have the skill.
Yeah, and it's a shame.
And that's just an amount of time.
She's got great roots. You know, she was a gymnast as a child. Olympic gymnast, or got into swimming as well, competitive swimming and bodybuilding. So it's like, yeah, you got some really good, strong foundations there.
Yeah, nobody's doubting her athletic prowess.
Yeah, I mean,
like I said, it's just all about skill and ring awareness, and she just doesn't have it yet. But like, if she continues to evolve, then, you know, we'll look back on her career with a, like, well, I was there when she didn't fuck up. And I was there when she actually put on a good match. Or I was there when she first carried a green wrestler in the ring. And, you know, that's...
Yeah.
We're going to look back on that with a misty, nostalgic eye. But now, today is just sort of like... It feels like we're watching a minor league game. You know what it is? It feels like this wrestling match was the equivalent of going out to spring training and seeing... going out to spring training and seeing your home baseball team go against their farm team.
You know, you're right, though. That's pretty good equation.
So. Like, Bailey, you know, Bailey didn't look spectacular against Dana, but this was sort of like a necessary match to try to save face going forward.
So Bailey wins.
Obviously.
Yeah.
Can you imagine if Dana won? Oh, my God. Bailey would never...
Ugh.
Bailey would be set 6 months back, at least.
Yeah.
Such is...
And you know what? I'm a huge fan of Bailey. I am. More than Dana. Because she's actually, you know, skilled right now.
She's, like, you know, a wrestler.
I mean, yeah, I mean, of course I'm more fond of... I'm more fond of Naomi. I'm more fond of Charlotte. I'm more fond of a lot of people than Dana. It's just that I, you know, I can look at things comparatively. I really want to see her grow.
Yeah.
So, moving on?
Yeah, moving on to the tag match between Enzo and Cass and the club. If I had to pick a match on this card that was the weirdest to watch, this was it, because the club won. The club should win. But the club didn't win in convincing fashion. But weirder than that was that the fact that they were booking Enzo and Cass so strong.
Not particularly Cass.
Particularly Cass, which isn't surprising when you find out that Vince was really high on the kid. But what really, really is weird is that how do you get... All right, you need a clean pin on Enzo. Enzo needs to take the pin in order for the club to get over. You need the club to get over in order for them to maintain some heel heat going forward. Okay, so how do you take care of Cass? Okay, so to make sure he doesn't, you know, run in and interrupt the tag, you cold cock him in the back of the head and he's out for like 3 minutes. After you just had him basically take care of the club single-handedly in the ring. Like, no joke, he goes inside the ring, takes both Gallows and Anderson... toe-to-toe, and he wipes the floor with them.
And who was he wailing on? Was it Gallows or Anderson when he just shoos the other guy off?
I think it was Anderson.
Yeah, but he's...
No, it was Gallows.
He's wailing on Gallows in the corner, and then Anderson, you know, walks up and is like, he tries to get him off of his partner, and he just does a... Get away, just kind of bats him like this, and he just goes flying. It's like, go away. I'm doing one guy right now.
I was like, I'll get to you in a minute.
You'll get your beating. And he keeps doing it. He comes back, and we're saying, no, get out of my partner. No. Beat. It's just the most hilarious thing. They're booking Cass like just freaking...
They're
dumb strong.
Like, you were about to say retard strong, weren't you?
Oh my God, you just said it!
This is the same company that
gave... You heal!
This is the same company that gave us Eugene, alright?
Don't mention his name! Nor the fact that Gallows was Festus. Don't mention that either!
That was a weird match to behold. Because it kind of turns... It really does turn him into kind of a glass cannon, a cast cannon, if you will. I got to it before you did. But the
No, you didn't.
You coined it while we were watching it, but I stole it from you.
Indeed, you did.
So all that matters is I made the joke first within the public view. That's all that matters in the end.
Mm.
But, I just don't see... I don't, like, they didn't win in convincing fashion. They needed to win, but they also needed to win in convincing fashion, and they just didn't do it. A win's a win, you can argue, and they won clean, or as clean as you can in tag team matches these days.
It was just they got back into the ring after getting their asses handed to them, and then they did their tag team move. What was it called again? I don't fucking remember.
I don't remember it. It's basically what amounts to an elevated neck breaker.
Yeah.
And, you know, they got the pin, 1-2-3. All right. You know, like, they hit their finishing move, they won. All right. That's fine. You know, like, that's true. But everything up to that was almost a squash match.
Yeah.
It was almost like the opposite of what happened to Clash of Champions.
And Cass
Where Clash of Champions, where they just dominated for, like, first 10 minutes of the match, and then the last 2 minutes, they took the pin and lost against the New Day.
Yeah.
Like, it was the complete opposite.
It was also a way to make Enzo look unnecessary. Like you needed to do that with Cass.
Like, all right. Also, Enzo, ever since Money in the Bank, it's just kind of been... His promos just kind of, like, fair to Midland. I mean, he's coasting.
Losing gas. We were thinking a possible future of X-Pac kind of heat. It was a possibility for a little while there.
He's not approaching it yet, but he's on the trajectory.
I mean, we're looking way ahead.
Yeah, but he needs more than just a thesaurus, more than just needing new jokes. I think he needs to actually get some momentum behind him as a singles competitor.
Yeah.
Because while Vince is high on Cass, Enzo is just... It used to be that Cass was catching the comet's tail that was Enzo. These days, Enzo's not going anywhere, so Cass is basically being elevated just by the virtue of the fact that... Excuse me. He's taking care of Gallows and Anderson single-handedly in the fucking ring. Why are we even bothering with Enzo?
No, that booking is not doing any favors for him, obviously. No.
I agree with. And I'm not even averse to having Cass be, you know, like, it being able to hold 2-on-1, because yeah. I think Cass has a big, great future ahead of him as a singles competitor.
Hell yeah, look at the guy.
Yeah, he looks great.
You know, if he can start having longer matches, maybe?
Yeah, like, if we can find him some... A good role to fit. I think he has not only IC champion. I could see him very easily, winning Money in the Bank.
Yeah, I mean,
I could very easily
hell
see.
Hell yeah!
Like I can a Universal champion. I can see him there, or World champion, depending if the
or maybe the Royal Rumble.
I wouldn't call him Royal Rumble. He like a big major face. Like I want. You know what I feel like Cass is? He's just one of those guys that needs to hold the title to legitimize him. Mm-hmm. His placement versus somebody who just earns it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
There are some people you want to win the title, and then there are some people who you look and say, the title should be on him.
Yeah.
Cass is one of those guys. He's not going to be like some plucky underdog trying to get the title. He's not going to be like some monster heel who's just going to wave it around. He just looks like a guy who says, like, yeah, you should hold the title.
You just need to see him do some matches now. He's very exploder right now. He's very... Mm-hmm. In and out.
In a way, he's kind of like a title warmer in a long way. Like, he's like an interim... He's like the perfect interim champion. Like, if you're grooming some future mega babyface, but you need some time to build that up, but, like, one of your monster heels got injured and he had the title, put it on Cass.
It sounds like you're describing Kevin Owens right now.
Well, Kevin Owens has more... Well, the booking is getting Kevin Owens... is holding back Kevin Owens right now. And the fact that Jericho is just doing what Jericho always does and steal the show. I mean, I don't blame WWE playing the hot hand here. But regardless, I feel like he's more like Sheamus back last year, where he cashed in Money in the Bank and then won that World Heavyweight Champion. He just basically held it until long enough people can get properly behind Roman for the 24 hours that he was over. I was there when it happened, but anyway...
But yeah, and so Enzo got some work to do.
Mm-hmm.
So
Cass,
we were really in for a little while,
but like
during the same time that he got injured.
Yeah.
I don't know. It seems like ever since that point, it's kind of been a little bit of loss of momentum. But
he's kind of petered out. But you know
that. No, oh, that. Sorry, but that thing with Sasha Banks didn't help either. Where he was supposed to tag. And he didn't. He missed the tag, so she had to just go in.
Yeah.
Without getting tagged, it was really. Yeah.
Oh yeah, that's not. I mean, we've all had our not proud moments. We are lucky enough that our not proud moments are being broadcasted to millions of people. But that's only because our audience isn't a million strong, yet. One day.
Oh, you guys are so kind.
We love you.
Yes, we do.
But speaking of Kevin Owens, his match with Seth Rollins is up next, which weird that they're putting the Universal Championship in the mid-card, but that just really shows how much they really think about the title right now. Or how much they really, really fucking believed in the women's championship. Anyway. Again, we'll get to it. But here's what wound up being, like, I had a feeling this was going to be a good match. And I wound up being proved true. That wound up being proved true. I think this is the match of the night. I mean, like, this was the second Hell in a Cell match, and it was everything you want in a Hell in a Cell match. Table spots. Chair shots galore. There was literally, I have it right here. Oh, what was it? God. There was a series of super kicks and clotheslines, and where it looked like everyone, like where both Kevin Owens.
There was literally a point where they had dueling super kicks, and they were no-selling each other's kicks. No, it was nuts.
And then, you know, Kevin Owens delivers a clothesline from hell and launched fucking Seth Rollins to orbit.
Yeah. It was just like, super kick, I don't give a shit, super kick, no sell.
Bam!
Bam! And he just goes flipping, it was just like in the old SmackDown game where you could break the physics.
that was beautiful, and seeing the slobber knocker brawl just devolve into pure madness when Jericho managed to get in, because of course he was going to get in.
He slithers his way in. He looks so proud of himself.
Yeah, and then awkwardly closing the cell back.
And to be fair, no one's ever done a good job of that.
So you know what, refs have never looked more ineffectual than when they're pleading with somebody to, hey, we'll drop that lock.
Chris Jericho's fumbling with the goddamn lock, and the referees, like, I think one of them was hollering from the side, and another referee's, like, trying to stop him, but, like, mud. Like, shit, I didn't start far enough away.
No, like
I gotta stop him.
Oh, God. But, like, but when he got involved, all of a sudden this brawl took a whole new life on its own, where Jericho basically turned it into a 2-on-1 handicap match inside Hell in a Cell, bringing in steel chairs. And there was like almost like a Steel Chair City moment where they're just wrapping each other with steel chairs.
Oh, God. Yeah, that was dueling chairs are awesome. I missed the concerto.
I did, too. And
well, nobody who's ever been hit by it misses it, of course.
Of course not. Good on you. I'm pretty sure WWE don't miss the concerto moveset.
No.
I mean, as much as we all kind of miss the curb stomp, nobody fucking misses concerto. That looked awful to take.
Yeah.
Anyone who's ever taken a concerto, you are a trooper, and there are no pants ruby enough for your massive balls. The only people who deserve more props for taking a concerto are the people who willingly took a vertebraker. For those of you who don't remember what a vertebraker is, it's when you get somebody in the arm lock, except they're upside down, which, you know, how the fuck do you set that up? But they're upside down, and then you basically sit it out, and they land either on the back of their neck or on their shoulders. Either way, I can't look at that move and not feel
you're probably hurting, you know, twice as much just talking about it.
Oh, yeah, like, I'm bringing up painful fucking memories.
Let's not talk about the invertebrate.
The vertebrae. Comparing the vertebrae to, like, the other, like, really, like, oh, my God, nobody will ever do that move, like the burning hammer. The true burning hammer, not the inverted AA. The actual one where I've seen the guy in Japan, I forgot his name, I've seen him do it. It's basically like a fireman's carry, except he sets him up like he's about to do like a sideways brainbuster, and then just drops him. Just like fucking like, roof, and the potato sack toss lands right on the back of his neck. If you're taking it correctly. That's if you're taking it correctly. If you're one false move and you're just like, you're done. You're landing right on your head, you're compressing your neck. It is it's Steve Austin at SummerSlam 97 all over again. Except now you don't have the pillowy thighs of Owen Hart to guide you down. Mm. Yeah, it's little wonder whenever the guy does it, and apparently he's only done it like 7 times. Whenever he's ever done it, nobody's ever kicked out of it. That move is more protected than the fucking...
couldn't kick out of it.
Yeah, like, That move is more protected than the fucking pedigree.
Wow, he's really selling that burning hammer. He's selling it good.
He's selling it good. In fact, he has a move.
I don't even see him breathing.
He has a move for 35 minutes. What a great job of selling. Man. Really committing. Yeah. But moving. But still about this match, not only was this a good Hell in a Cell match, I dare say one of the best I can remember seeing. I'm not going to put it up there with...
Well, let me put it this way. I thought that there was going to be much better in this event, and there wasn't. So by virtue of nothing else comparing to it, it was the best.
But, like, even let's not shortchange this match.
I'm not trying to shortchange it. It was pretty solid. It was a pretty solid match. I don't think it blew me away as much as it did you, but I definitely enjoyed it.
I look at what had to be done in order to set up the spots in this match, and I'm thinking, like, if this were in the hands of lesser wrestlers, then they would just, like, not even care about the fact that, you know, they're laboriously dragging tables up and they're trying to set up for the spot. Kevin Owens has an ability of making the act of setting up an elaborate spot for to be used somewhere along in the match and turn it into its own brand of entertainment.
Kevin Owens and his spatial awareness. It's like a sixth sense for him.
Yeah, like the little things. Like the fact that he immediately goes underneath the ring to try to get a weapon. Because why wouldn't you? Like, remembering
that he has to go get his check mechs that are hidden in that little alcove on the ring post.
Yeah, I still don't understand what that was. Like, somewhere in the beginning of the match, he just grabs something off of Seth Rollins' wrist, I want to say, or hand. And then, like, it looks like he's grabbing around there. It could have been somewhere else. But he just holds it up and then just, like, puts it in his mouth and chews.
What, is that what he did?
Yeah.
I thought he grabbed something from, like, over in the corner.
No, it was right. It might have been, like, in the corner, but Seth Rollins was there. Like, in the being held up against the ropes. Like, I don't know what the hell
was he eating then? I just figured he had some, like, Whoppers or something.
Like, he has, like, a little bit of, like, you know
Skittles
how...
Skittles or something.
You know how, like, there's, like, that drink caddy underneath the ring that's filled with, like, Gatorade that's always there under the ring for some reason? Like, maybe that's where he keeps his Whopperitos or his...
I don't know, he grabs something. He starts... I don't know what the hell he's doing. I don't know. It's like Kevin Owens has got to eat during his match, you know? Gets hungry.
Mm-hmm. Oh, but let's... besides the whole hardware, you know, hardware store angle of this... he sets up two tables to take, you know, two tables where he's powerbombed through and, you know, is left in a heap of his own unconsciousness, and that was beautiful. But beyond... like huge elaborate spots like that. There was also like the inventive angles and the hard hitting brutal angles that I think was missing in future matches. Mm-hmm. I mean, like there was some brutality, but nothing as brutal as Seth Rollins taking a senton splash while he's bridging.
Oh, that was harsh.
Yes.
Oh, like more stuff at the back. It's always,
yeah. Like he took two senton splashes at the exact same time, like one after another. That was, while he's trying to get up, so like he's taking that on his hands and knees, and I am in awe that his back did not buckle underneath that. That was amazing. And the other spots were like cannonball right into the corner of the corner into the ring post, then into the corner of the cell. It's, you know, like moments like that that really elevate it beyond just like your standard hardcore match. I mean, they didn't use the kendo. I wish they used more kendo sticks. If I'm a mark for anything hardcore, it's kendo sticks. Because it always felt to me like, you know what?
You must have enjoyed Steve Blackman then.
Oh yeah, I did. I loved the weapon specialist. But I loved the kendo sticks because there is no out to it. There is no gimmick to a kendo stick. You just whap them as hard as you can, and you just take it. It is.
Well, you're a believer now that you've been hit with a pull cue.
I've been hit with a pool cue, but I've taken way worse bumps. That pool cue was made out of balsa wood. You could break that pool cue by just swinging it too hard.
Well, that's what I'm saying. You love those kendo sticks because...
I love those kendo sticks because, one, when hit right, they leave a good mark on your body. It hurts, but it's not like, oh my god, ah, Jesus, fuck, why did I do that? It's like, you're not in danger of, like shortening your life. It's just pain.
Yeah.
And people can look at that pain and believe the pain. It's, you, like, you're not asking the audience...
It's the sweet spot of entertainment versus risk.
Yes, exactly. Like, you know it's painful. You, like, everyone's been hit with a ruler. It fucking hurts.
Yeah.
it doesn't look like it, but you know that you'll live. But you know, like,
yeah, it makes it easier to sell the pain when it's actually real.
Yeah.
Method acting in wrestling.
I mean, like...
Stanislavski's guide to fucking taking bumps.
I mean, at the end of the day, it's an easier job to ask the audience to believe what you're selling if what you're selling is the truth.
Yeah.
And when you're hit with a kendo stick, it hurts. And that's why whenever I see it out, I was like, you know what? Kudos.
Yeah.
You were willing to take the punishment.
And boy, does he fucking take it. Those were some of the more hard hits I've seen from a kendo stick in a while.
Oh, yeah.
Especially in the
Rusev era. We're going back to Rusev, yeah.
But for
this fight, the fact that they didn't rely on the kendo sticks and just relied on the standard tables and chairs, mm-hmm. and they were able to have not only some brutal spots without them, but creative spots that didn't require, like, fucking eight tables to be launched up on, you know, elevated up on high stilts and such like that. Not like, this isn't TLC 3, but to see, like, to see Seth Rollins getting powerbombed through two steel chairs that just crumpled up and then rolled over for the pin, that was great. That was what you want in a Hell in a Cell match. And for me, that is why this is the match of the night.
Well, it was the match of the night for me as well.
Mm-hmm. If Rusev and Roman Reigns was a bog standard, that's, you know, textbook Hell in a Cell with some nice tasty spots. That is Hell in a Cell done not exceedingly well. That's a little too strong. But this is Hell in a Cell done as far as you can go without doing bleeding.
Yeah.
Intentional blood.
There was something missing from the match, though. I was sad it wasn't there. There was no headlock. Where was the headlock master?
It's a Kevin Owens match. It can't be a Kevin Owens match without a headlock.
Yeah, I know. It's really weird.
Grab something to eat it. It's the little things. Like when Kevin Owens has him up against the side of the cell, and he's ripping off the kinesio tape off his back, and fucking Seth Rollins sounds like fucking Dragon.
Ah!
He sounds like Goku trying to summon up the fucking spirit bomb.
Ah! Ah! God, that voice. He is heel to the bone.
And
he does not sound face when he's screaming.
No,
he doesn't. God.
Yeah.
He's loud.
He is like a cat in the garbage disposal.
But Kevin Owens, I always fucking love watching Kevin Owens. He's incredible.
It's just a shame that...
Right now, Jericho really is taking the spotlight away from him.
Which...
They don't work well together, in my opinion.
Not anymore, they don't. They used to. They used to work well together. But now, you know, but I think that's intentional. Because... They're building up to this eventual
feud.
They're going to split at some time or another, and right now, like, we're being primed for it. Like, we're being ready ready for this to come. And when it happens, it's going to be glorious.
It just feels like Kevin Owens really not been
at
his top game as far as personality.
Yeah, which means, you know, like, when it happens, and it will happen, probably by Survivor Series, then it's just going to be awesome. Because we're all going to be on board.
And hopefully we can get the Kevin Owens.
Because now we have Kevin Owens against Jericho. Now, whether or not this will actually lead to a good match is debatable. Because as good as Jericho is on the mic and as a personality, his in-ring skills still revolve around code breakers and lion tamers. And
no lion tamers anymore.
No, not on lion tamers.
Lion salts?
Yeah. No, not even lion salts anymore.
Well, then lion what?
Lying in wait until
lying
he can
wait.
Wait until he has to go into the ring, I suppose.
Well, he sure did a lot of lying in the Royal Rumble.
Certainly more than not as much as Roman Reigns. Nobody lied in wait as much as Roman Reigns did.
Well, that's true, but the thing is, I don't know if it's Jericho that is the bane of Kevin Owens as much, or if it's the title.
I think it's. You know what? It's the booking. I think it's the booking. Because Kevin Owens can make a belt legitimate. I think he can.
He should be able to.
He should be able to. And I think if... I know he can. You can't get where he got without being able to legitimize whatever you throw around his shoulders.
Well, then there's the, but then there's the preservation, there's the continuation of holding that title well.
Yeah, well, here's the thing. Like, I think what happened was, they were, you know, they set him up with Jericho because they would work well together. But then fucking SummerSlam happened and Finn Balor went down. And now they figured, okay.
Okay.
We got this vacant title. What are we going to do with it?
Might have been a little early thing.
Yeah, but... like, it might have been that they were going to run along. They were great together when Kevin didn't have a title because they were just working off each other. But now they realize, well, okay, we can't give it to Seth because Seth, we're going to turn him face pretty soon. Mm-hmm. Well, why don't we give it to Kevin? Kevin, you know, Kevin is a great heel. We could definitely move him along that way.
And it will certainly legitimize him as, you know, a heavy hitter.
Yeah, and all of that wound up being true.
I miss my Kevin Owens that would go out there and grab, you know, Michael Cole's phone or whoever's phone it was, I don't remember, but he would grab the guy's, you know, phone and just smash it into the ground and who would, you know, go out there and, you know, line up like he's going to do this amazing stunt and then just do a kick or a headlock. Yeah. I miss the antics.
I miss the antics too. The problem is that when you're the champion and now you have this hanger-on, now all of a sudden the dynamic changes. And that dynamic is not doing Kevin Owens any favors. It's doing Jericho a lot of favors, but, you know, Jericho's had his career and he doesn't need the rub anymore. So him fighting for the title doesn't really make sense to me, but I suppose from a booking angle, how can you not? So on one hand, Jericho versus Kevin Owens for the Universal Championship is a match that is inevitable and makes sense on paper, but I don't see it doing anything other than finalizing the fact that we're no longer a team anymore. So it's a sad end to what was a good moment for both men up until the Universal title had to be put on Kevin Owens. So, you know, bad news bear on both sides.
Bad news Barrett.
Bad news Barrett. But we'll see how that plays out. And more importantly, I want to see what happens with Seth Rollins.
Isn't that ironic? Bad news, Barrett really did turn out to be bad news for him.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway.
Anyway, Seth Rollins, you fought like hell. And you'll get back on your feet one day. You're going to get that title one day, but not without a confrontation with Triple H. Probably for WrestleMania.
Pedigree versus bigger pedigree.
Mm-hmm. Either it's going to be at SummerSlam. It's either going to be at WrestleMania or it's going to be at the Royal Rumble. Either way, I'm looking forward to it. More likely, it's going to be at the Royal Rumble. Brian Kendrick versus TJ Perkins. Another case of who gives a shit. I mean, I don't want to be down on cruiserweight. I don't want to be down on cruiserweight.
Brian Kendrick versus TJ Perkins, moving on. No, we are going to cover it. We covered the Bayley Dana Brooke match. We can cover
this. I suppose, but it's just such a nondescript fart of a match. I mean... It's a lame-ass fucking match. Hurried along to its inevitable conclusion. Not just... I'm kind of speechless at this point because there's such a nothing match.
So, TJ Perkins is a, apparently video game character of a man.
Mm.
Who... actually doesn't really do a lot having to do with video games in the ring or anything like that, gimmick-wise. I mean, he just kind of has the entrance. But in any case, that whole thing felt a little pandering to me. But
yeah, like that is a very pandering entrance. It's a very Scott Pilgrim in that sense.
Yeah,
but
and the guy, he has no personality, but...
we should definitely... During the match, one of the... I think it was Byron Saxton.
Oh, yeah.
It was definitely Byron Saxton who said, "This is an interesting contrast to personality." What personality? TJ Perkins has no personality.
The contrast
and
of
Brian
personality.
Brian Kendrick, you know, he calls his move sliced bread because he's about as boring as white bread.
He's about as
interesting as white
interesting
bread.
as Wonder Bread.
Is Wonder Bread.
So...
The very definition of vanilla... vanilla midgets.
I mean, the thing is, the guy looks like he's charismatic from his appearance,
but he's
really not.
And the booking is terrible. The booking is just awful. Like, where he's basically telling TJ Perkins to lay down, take the pin, because I need this. Why? Like, he's like, well, I'm 37, man. I don't have much time left. Fucking AJ Styles is 39.
Yeah.
John Cena is 39. You got more...
And it's not like you're just made it out of, you know, training ground.
Yeah, and it's not like you're a roided up, you know, fucking ballistic freak who's about one heart attack away from, you know, like, from ending his career at 42.
Yeah, you're a returning veteran, supposedly, so... someone like that is supposed to come in hard, not even at the point of putting people over, maybe even, but come in really hard. Not come in there asking for somebody to lay down for you. What the fuck?
What in the good goddamn hell? And so, a lot of cruiserweight bullshit happening. There's a spot where he tries to tape TJ Perkins' hand to the rope, but the tape doesn't...
Oh, he tries to use his medical tape to tie his wrist to the
ring, to the ropes.
The bottom rope. And...
But it doesn't do anything. It doesn't stick. It's just awful. It's a... I thought it was going to be the most embarrassing moment of the night. I was proven wrong. But nothing... Like, everything about this match was just... Like, I hate agreeing with Vince about calling them vanilla midgets. I do. Because I feel like, the, you know, they're... Like, it's infamously Vince's words. Like, he doesn't like... Like, he likes big, you know, big-bodied tough guys. He doesn't like... good big bodies. He doesn't like what he considers vanilla midgets. But the point, excuse me. Yeah, but when you're not, I don't know who's writing the storylines or booking.
Yeah, this one's really got you befuddled.
Yeah, it does. Like, because like everything about this match doesn't make sense. Brian Kendrick is number one contender for the Cruiserweight Championship. That I get. Why the fuck is he begging for, you know, begging? This makes him look weak. And then makes T.J. Perkins look awful.
Well, so, the best I can think is maybe he's asking him to lay down so that he doesn't have to take it to extremes and really hurt him.
But no, he makes it very clear. He's like, I'm near the end of my career. I need this rub or else I'm out. Yeah. Like, is there some kind of contract stipulation?
It's lame. Why would...
It's like...
Don't... That is just pitiful.
Yeah. And worse still is that it... All of this crap surrounding this match, which is a fairly nice cruiserweight match.
Yeah, it doesn't have like any botches or anything.
Like everything is technically sound. I mean, not as impactful as I would like, but I think that has more to do with both wrestlers having more technically proficient, you know, finesse moves rather than.
I mean, yeah, but like they do suplexes, they do some, I guess, arm drags and stuff and mm-hmm. locks. Some submissions. He has the captain's hook, which is, I guess, a chin lock.
Yeah, like a...
It's a chin lock.
It's a chin lock. So, whatever. It's... Anyway, he wins the match. You know, Brian Kendrick wins the match by feigning injury and then catching T.J. Perkins off guard.
T.J. Perkins puts his hands over his face so you can't tell he doesn't give a shit.
And then, you know, snaps it up. Was it a schoolboy pin? I think it was a schoolboy pin, and then just...
I think he goes into the captain's hook. He goes into the
captain's hook, and then he taps. And then...
And for a guy who's supposed to be, like, you know, the Johnny Depp pirate, he really lacks the charisma.
He's just...
Not that I want him to be, like, that one wrestler. I forgot his name.
Yeah, I forgot.
Who literally was the gimmick.
Yeah.
I don't want him to go around there, where's the rum and shit? Thank you for not doing booking him that way.
But actually, you know what? I kind of prefer that. At least he'd be...
At least there's something.
At least there'd be a flavor. At least there'd be like...
Be a terrible flavor, but...
You know what? It's something to grab onto.
Maybe the
versus
crowd...
Versus the nothing.
Yeah, like the crowd can boo, have somebody to boo. Instead of just being silent the entire match.
Yeah, like...
Or not even there, maybe in the bathroom.
Yeah.
But they were really not behind that match, and neither were we.
And it's not fair to the cruiserweights.
It's sad.
It's not fair to the cruiserweights that the audience, you know, like... is either passive or openly contemptualizing just the mere fact that they're watching a cruiserweight fight. But on the other hand, WWE doesn't really make it any easier for them by not getting any of the cruiserweights any juicy material to work with. They're just kind of, let's fight. Yeah, let's fight. Okay. Boom, we fought. Moving on. And moving on. This wound up being more... interesting than I thought it would wind up being. The New Day versus Sheamus and Cesaro. I'm calling Cesaro.
Not Sabaro?
No. Cesaro. Until somebody corrects me, I'm going to call him Cesaro for the Tag Team Championship. Now, part of me knew that the tag that you know, this is as close as anyone has ever gotten to beating the record that nobody gave a shit about until WWE told us to give a shit about. And that's the what was it? Marauders, Murders, like some tag team that nobody gave a shit about, hence why they were able to hold on to the titles for that goddamn long. And now they're realizing, hey, we got a story with this. Even though, like, the New Day has been floundering for the last 4 months, arguably, as far as relevance, it's just been this long, drawn-out, protracted march towards the inevitable. I get that. So, you know, Sheamus and Cesaro not winning the belts, I'm fine with.
I have an inkling.
I'm fine with that. But what did surprise me is that they went for the DQ finish.
I'm wondering if they're going to sidetrack a little bit, but I'm wondering if they're going to just kind of end their reign right before reaching the title.
It's entirely possible. It'd be a very...
Like, are they going to cut the... I'm wondering, because, I mean, that's kind of might be how I'd book it.
Yeah.
Just because it's more interesting than actually beating the record is if they actually got, like, one day or one week.
Like, if it wound up being that, you know, like, if the day before... Their record is going to break was right. It was like right on either Raw or on a pay-per-view. Then it's a done deal. There's no better way to play it. Mm-hmm. But if it turns out that the day before is like Thursday, then there's no point. They're just going to wait it out.
Yeah.
So
there's kind of that.
Yeah. So like that, it depends on what day the calendar lands. You know, like whether or not they're going to lose on TLC or...
Because honestly, it's the better story.
Yeah, it is.
And, it's the more interesting story.
And imagine the heel heat that the people that are going to take those belts off of New Day are going to get.
Yeah, it gets things done.
Mm-hmm. So, looking that too far ahead, while we should be looking right here in the flesh and blood of the now, I'm surprised that they were trying to keep Cesaro...
I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's fine. No, it's a fun thing. It's a fun thing to wonder about. I get it. But I'm actually surprised that they're keeping Cesaro strong. They're booking him strong.
Because they're not booking his shoulders strong.
Yeah, like, seriously, Cesaro, if your shoulder isn't good by now...
Just have it removed and replace it with Bionic.
You are apparently a Swiss super agent. I think MI6 or your Swiss equivalent are equipped with Bionic shoulders. You know, it's all that stolen Nazi gold you could find.
But it was really nice of him to finally lend his medical tape out to the other wrestlers of this event.
Mm-hmm. Everyone from Sasha Banks to
Seth Rollins.
Yeah. You know, like, yeah. When people ask, like, who are the faces in any match? Look for the person with the fucking kinesio tape.
I kind of wonder what that tape feels like, if it has, like, a rigid surface.
I know it's, like, supposed to, like... It's actually kind of tight, and so, like, it's supposed to contract muscles.
Really?
Yeah.
Because it just looks like fucking tape to me.
Yeah, I know. It's like, that's apparently what they're supposed to do, but I don't know. Like, I've never felt it against my body. So,
Maybe she just got, like, a big-ass pauldron.
You know what? You know what? It's near Halloween time. Why don't we just make the return of the Yate and just have him just covered in fucking kinesio tape?
That's just a tape mummy.
Oh, boy.
At least then you don't know which shoulder it is. Okay.
Yeah. It's like, ha, you don't know what part of my body is really hurt. Damaged.
Maybe it's all of it. I'm in great pain all the time. That's my secret. I'm always hurt.
Why am I doing wrestling? I look like fucking Homer Simpson after he took that gorge dive.
where were we?
We were at the Cesaro getting DQ'd by interference from Kofi Kingston, of all people.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Now,
who was actually not in the match?
Not in the match,
which is kind of different.
Different, and I like it when Xavier wrestles, because it's a nice reminder of what he can do.
Yeah, like when he was in NXT and he was the he had that, what was it, undercover brother look, the afro and the funk music. He came out with the Funkadactyls, I think.
Yeah, those were dark days. But
But at least he had was wrestling more.
Yeah, he was wrestling more often.
And boy, he's freaking ripped. You don't notice it that much from, you know, the spandex he wears and the gimmick with the what was it, the boss from Hairdo? I think he kind of stopped doing that, though, but it was hilarious.
But, like, with Francesca, and, that became his gimmick and his...
Yeah, but he's actually really freaking ripped.
Like, you know, playing the whole Jimmy Hart, you know, kind of annoying manager for the... He's, like, the annoying manager. But it was nice to see him get back into the ring. Yeah. And even though there was some spots where he wasn't exactly very crisp, especially on a fairly lackluster Hurricane Rana, where Cesaro kind of had to help him along to launch himself... That wasn't exactly very nice. But everything else about the match was it was sort of like Roman Reigns and Rusev. It was like kind of started off slow, but it built up and built up and built up. It was a nice spot after nice spot.
And lots of, you know, like marital squabbles between Sheamus and Cesaro.
including this nice squabbling bit where they... get Xavier Woods in a corner, and they just keep tagging each other in to lay down.
I think that was the most consecutive tags I've ever seen in one actual segment. That was really... I'm surprised I've never seen it before like that. I mean, I guess I'm not. It's pretty stupid in theory, but it looked, the way they did it was really funny.
Yeah, like, you know, credit to both Cesaro and Sheamus for working that angle and being pretty funny at it, too. I mean, like, this is comedy working... This is working comedy in wrestling, which often doesn't work, right, Dr. Gallows and Anderson?
Ugh.
But, followed by probably the most brutal spot of that entire match, where Xavier Woods took a coup de grace from fucking...
From Cesaro, I think. Yeah.
I mean, that's the worst person. Like, everyone looks at... I would rather take a coup de grace... from
Finn Balor?
From Finn Balor.
Than from fucking Cesaro. Then again, Cesaro is so goddamn skilled. Like, not saying that Finn Balor isn't. Well, and that's his finisher. But Cesaro is so fucking good that I imagine that he can just come off as light as a feather when he does that to you.
Indeed possible. But, like, here's the, like, thing. Like, a 250-pound Irishman from the top ropes, 270-pound Swiss man just...
Well, I mean, in writing, it sounds like an obvious choice there, but Cesaro is really good. And also, he's very lean.
Mm.
I get the feeling he has a lot of control over his extremities.
Considering how he's able to, like, some of the feats of strength that he is capable of doing.
Yeah, like putting those glory holes in Hell in a Cell.
I almost took that on face value for a moment. You have this amazing ability to tell a joke with the straightest face, and it takes me a little while.
Like, that was a good one too, Gabe. What? Wait, what did you say?
Like, he's like, wait a minute. Like, your tone of your voice doesn't suggest that you're joking, but your words are so ridiculous that they have no choice but to be joking. That's an art, man. That is an art.
But, artiste.
Yeah, so the match didn't go New Day's way, so Kofi Kingston takes Francesca and... Sheamus uses Francesca on...
That's right, yeah, he did it first.
He did it first.
He grabs Francesca and...
Francesca the second.
Rest in peace, the first.
And now rest in peace, the second.
And now rest... Ah, fuck.
Yeah, he probably bent it over. Oof. So, be on the lookout for Francesca the third.
Maybe a kazoo this time around.
They're gonna steal a page book out of Edge and Christian.
Oh yeah. Yeah, boy.
Like Edge and Christian had kazoos. Remember the Attitude Era?
I don't know how they're gonna use a kazoo as a foreign object though.
I don't know. They could probably do like a William Regal thing and just hide it under tights and then just like...
It was like a brass kazoo.
Oh yeah, it's a brass kazoo. Sounds like shit though. Hurts like a bitch. I mean, kazoos already sound like shit, but a brass kazoo is just... It's like I love that Futurama joke where they have a fiddle contest for a fiddle made of gold, but a fiddle made of gold...
It actually sounds like shit. Oh.
Yeah. But they were losing the fight, and then Kofi interfered and caused the DQ. But he caused the DQ while he... While Xavier Woods was tapping from the sharpshooter. So, you know, now we got some friction going on here. So I'm thinking maybe Cesaro takes the tag teams off of New Day.
Oh, no way, man. Nah.
Well, what other tag team would it be? It's certainly not the club.
Cesaro. I like it. Cesaro is not meant to stick.
I don't know. Like, part of me wants them to stick. Oh.
I would love to see them stick.
I
would love to see them take the titles off of New Day. But most, I think a lot of that is because I know it won't happen.
But if it does.
Ah, oh, come on.
I know we just had our hearts broken by having our anticipation and our eagerness set too high. But
that would be amazing, though.
Like, they're the only tag teams right now that are booked strong enough
and
to,
it would be,
to be a legitimate threat to them, though.
And it would be a really good statement about how much they deserve and they aren't getting.
Exactly. I feel like both men need the titles, in a way. But, and more importantly, I think the New Day need that threat.
They really do.
The club used to be that threat, but then they booked it terribly.
And the Wyatts was just fizzled to nothing.
Fizzled to nothing because of the brand split.
I kind of liked their segment where they did the, what was that? The Jeff Hardy, Matt Hardy thing. Where
edited
wrestling thing.
You mean the final deletion?
Yeah. When they did it with the New Day and the Wyatt family, it actually was kind of neat. It was kind of
fun. I hate edited wrestling. I really hate
it. Well, so do I, because it defeats the purpose of this scripted, but non-edited.
But it's supposed to be at least, you know, like a display of athleticism of like a sport.
Yeah, and if you can edit it, well, how much else can you fake? So, like, suddenly, you know, bleeding and all these other things is just no more point. But bringing it back, I'd love to see them take the titles, just because it would be like a reminder of why are you not booking these guys for higher titles. Like, you put these two guys with no experience with each other, or who have not done very much tag team wrestling routinely.
Well, Cesaro had Cesaro and Tyson Kidd.
That was right.
Cesaro and Tyson Kidd. Yeah.
And there was also Cesaro and Jack Swagger.
The True Americans?
Not that I want to remember that, but the True Americans was a tag team.
He's like, I always loved Cesaro's attitude towards that. He's like... I guess I'm American.
I'm Swiss, but
we the people.
We the people. But that was hilarious. but basically, these two guys who have no experience with each other. You put them together, they win the titles immediately. And it's like, well, shit, son. They're pretty fucking good, aren't they?
Yeah.
Why are we not putting these guys for higher titles if they can just make shit work like that? You know, it's
And you know what? It's like there's more opportunity. I think there's more opportunity with Cesaro and Sheamus than there was with the club. I don't know. Like, I guess I've never been too high on the club, even when they were being booked strong against the New Day and they were more of a threat to take their tag titles. But that train has since left the station. Good luck with Enzo and Cass, buddies. Good luck with Enzo and Cass.
But yeah, and we both like Sheamus. We do.
Yeah.
A lot of people apparently don't.
Because for a heel, he doesn't really have anything to grab onto as far as like heat other than his hair.
The Mohawk, I get it. It's the Celtic warrior tribal kind of thing. I get it. But on the other hand, I think he might look better if he just had long hair, maybe in like braids or some shit, you know?
Well... Finally, that time of the night.
I really didn't want to get to this. I really fucking didn't.
Especially since it began so well, because, you know, Gabe has always been about, like, I want, like, an entrance for women like Triple H used to get for his WrestleMania entrances. Where he being dragged to the ring, you know, with hot dudes carrying her, and that's exactly how...
That's exactly what I got. And that sharp. I was so, so, so pumped. I was so pumped.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that was beautiful. That was perfect. That was just what we needed.
Charlotte getting, you know, on a throne, getting carried to the ring with centurions.
Carrying. Oh, that was great.
That was great. And then in comes...
And then in comes fucking Sasha Banks in
her Cadillac Escalade.
Wow.
Like, Cadillac Escalade. Like, I'm... It's like, get it? Because, like, Big Poppy, except Big Poppy, you know, drove a lowrider convertible where, you know, had some...
Charlotte comes in on the throne. Sound like Chris... I like Chris Walker. She comes in on the throne carried by Roman soldiers. You're coming in a Cadillac Escalade and... Like, it's a car! You're just coming in a car. It's just a black car.
You're like, what is this, 2006? Like Cadillac Escalades used to be like the, you know, Pimp My Ride bling mobiles back in the day, but that was over a decade ago. I haven't heard of or thought about the Cadillac Escalade since.
It was ridiculous. I mean, it's not even a limo. It's not even like when JBL does it. It wasn't as grand as that. It was just kind of like, this is the black vehicle that you see people constantly going, you know, being brought to the backstage area, the parking lot, when it's a random superstar. And so that was her thing, and it was just kind of lackluster. It wasn't blingy. It wasn't legit boss to me. I don't even like the legit boss getup thing to begin with. That's just my thing. So, but this didn't even match the gimmick for me that much. It just kind of, like, maybe she could have came in like a what was it? Dark Horse, like, what was that freaking I can't remember the name, but that freaking, like, gold music video that was done for Katy Perry.
Oh, Katy Perry's...
Dark Horse, I think it was called.
Oh, like the, like, coming up on some kind of, like, Egyptian raft?
Yeah, like some kind of ridiculously over-the-top bling fest, like gold everywhere, because that's what she's about.
Like, you know, well, she's about, you know, bling and being, like, you know... That idea.
She's about being over-the-top tacky.
Over-the-top tacky, but...
So I expected a really over-the-top tacky entrance.
Yeah, like, you know, that's... I think that might have been the problem. Like, the Escalade, for being supposedly, like, the king of vehicles that you bling out, there is not exactly... It wasn't exactly blinged out.
No, it was
like,
just there was black...
Just black, black nondescript, ugly-looking Cadillac Escalade, so...
All right. It didn't shout out. It didn't stand out next to Charlotte's.
Yeah, like, she... You know, popped out of the moonroof and then like, yay, it's me, I'm the boss. And then crawls out and then bam, then the match begins without beginning with Charlotte, you know, just cold cocking Sasha. And then before the gates can even properly close. So they just start brawling and it spills out into the audience. And then we were thinking for a moment, like, it's not going to be a Hell in a Cell match.
We were really fucking worried.
You know what?
Now we wish it wasn't.
You know what? Fine, just pull another Brock Lesnar and Randy Orton and just jerk us around
before the real Hell in a Cell match or something.
Or yeah, exactly. And so it spills out into the audience. So I'm thinking, okay, so at the very least they'll just have like a street brawl.
And there's a spot. It's like the cage is going to lower onto Sasha. Which is all right. That was actually kind of interesting. Yeah. Like I don't think I've ever seen that before, where it looked like the cage was going to crush somebody. I mean, it's so slow though. I don't think it would.
No, she would have. If she had any brain, she'd roll out the way.
Yeah, but I mean that was a thing. And
you know, like it spills out into the audience. Then we go into a field trip for a little bit, and then there's this really awkward looking, not at all interesting looking spot where, for one reason or another, Charlotte, you know, splays out Sasha onto the announce table. Tries to climb up, thinking, like, okay, she's going to, like, drop off from, like, you're thinking, okay, she's going to drop off from some elevated height to do, like, I don't know.
A Shane elbow.
Yeah. Or, like, a Shane elbow. She doesn't even get up, like, past the second part of the cage, sorry, cell. It's not a cage, it's a cell. All of a sudden, Sasha just gets up, and then she awkwardly tries to get her legs, you know, like, no, Sasha starts climbing again and starts, like, punching her, and it looks really, really awkward. And then Charlotte drops down, but then has to, like, all right, you. This is where you get on my shoulders now. Okay, all right, whatever. Okay, and then powerbomb you through the announce table. And, okay. I've heard people defend this by saying, like, you know, like, trying to get the audience involved with what is what is happening.
Yeah.
But, and considering how much Mick Foley was hyping up this match, I knew exactly what they were going to do, and I was annoyed to fucking shit because of it. It's like, oh yeah, like, well, King of the Ring 98, he fell off the top of the cage, and then there was like a five or 10 minutes where, you know, he was being led off on a stretcher. Here's the thing, though. Mick Foley fell off the top. Sasha was just powerbombed through a rigged table. A gimmick table, rather. This is not equal at all. So when you're calling out the stretcher for, like, oh my god, Sasha just got powerbombed through an announce table. Something that happens to men all the goddamn time.
They honestly, I think there's just a button they fucking push to make it collapse or something when they
yeah.
Which is why sometimes you see a person just standing on it and it collapses.
Yeah. Like, you could make the argument that, like, well, women don't powerbomb each other through the announce table. That never happens. And you're right. It doesn't happen. But
that was the first time. Woo.
Woo. And you're
But if this is a match, I'm sorry. If this is a match that's only merit is, oh, it was the first time that I saw this happen and there's absolutely nothing else good about it, then that's just cheap.
I mean, like, granted, everything has to be a first, but that's not... You get the credit to being the first, but all this does is just make me wonder why aren't there more spots where women powerbomb each other through the announce table? I mean, Nia Jax, you know, powerbombing Bayley through that would be awesome.
It would be. It would be really cool.
And I guarantee you that if she does do it, they're not gonna waste our goddamn time for 10 minutes or however long it was. Certainly felt longer than 10 minutes. Having this spot where, like, we gotta get the stretcher and wasting our fucking time.
That was so fucking stupid. Wait. That was just saying that, oh, these spots have way more impact on a woman than they do a man. This isn't the point of the match. This is to show that women can do just as fine as the men do. They can take the same spots. They can deliver the same fucking blows. This was really, really just embarrassing and sad. And I literally was just like, I was blushing this entire time. I felt so bad for Charlotte and Sasha.
Mm-hmm. And so when, you know, she finally, like, you know, like, broad checks some EMTs and, like, no, I'm gonna fight after 8 solid minutes of overacting. And just, like, finally, and then they get inside the ring, and then the match actually fucking begins after, like, a fake out, saying, like, well, due to injury, the new women's champion is Charlotte, and then, like, Sasha gets up, nah!
Okay, so, I promise you guys, I know, probably sounds like we're nitpicking at this point, and, you know, in a way, we kind of are, sure, but let me guarantee you that this does not end well. This match really doesn't end well. It's not a, like, it's up for debate kind of thing.
Like, nobody agreed with the ending on this
fight. This
even the people who defended this match don't like the ending.
They have to say, you know, well or but. It's one of those. It was just a travesty. It was just a train wreck. There were a few things that were done okay. But... as a normal match on a normal program like Raw, this would have been a bad match. And for the first Women's Hell in a Cell match, it was just absolutely abysmal. It brings new meaning to the term Hell in a Cell.
So, like, after we had, like, that embarrassing, you know, the embarrassing spot where, you know, like, have we all gone potty? Are we ready to begin this match now?
So, like, we get it. When Mick Foley got injured, now he did this big promo to up the stakes, and now you're going to do the same thing. Maybe even have a tooth from somewhere fly into your nose.
If only. Actually, I don't want Sasha or Charlotte to injure themselves the way they did. The way that Undertaker and Mankind did. But
no, nobody wants that for anyone.
No, of course, we don't want, like, them to, like, literally blade each other open and, you know, try to, like, and, like, eat, like, a bed on a, and, like, take a fucking...
Thumbtack
shower or whatever. But don't waste our fucking time.
And don't botch every single fucking spot. Like, every single... almost every single, like foreign object that's being used in here is... The tables were just not with them. And they weren't with the tables.
No. And when they were wrestling and grappling, they were all right. Like,
which was very, very little of the match.
Yeah, like...
I remember one suplex, maybe one hold.
Yeah, like, when, you know, when Sasha's driving her knees into Charlotte at the edge of the cell, that's fine. Yeah, that looks nice. That looks brutal. And especially when she's, you know, doing a Spider-Man crawl and then launches herself from the elevated height and then lands on Charlotte knees first on her chest.
Yeah, that was a great spot. I enjoyed that. I haven't seen that.
Yeah, but every time they will whip out either a table or a chair, they look so lost holding these things. Like, Charlotte's trying to set up a table on the outside of the apron, and then you're thinking, okay, this is going to lead to a spot where she superplexes Sasha into the table. Okay, that's going to be awesome. And then you think, no, there's no way they're going to do that. So maybe that's going to be like she's going to be like, it's going to stay there, and then it's going to be like, oh, she's going to toss her over the ring, and then she's going to land on the table. And table and shatter, and that's going to be fine because, you know, Charlotte threw a table. That's fine. What happens is, no, she, you know, punches her way out of the superplex and then gently nudges Charlotte, and then she lands on the table and it collapses and it looks awful. Even the audience, who were so hyped for this match, booed this. I booed with it too. God damn, that was one of the most embarrassing table spots I've ever seen. Not as much as that Scotty Too Hottie match that you...
At least that was funny.
This is... I felt like both women just wanted to die.
This wasn't funny at all. This wasn't funny.
This was sad.
Like, Scotty Too Hottie's heel breaking a table was... Yeah. It was fucking Scotty Too Hottie. It's like, this is karma. But this was just sad, and it was hurtful. It was just pain. It was pain. I mean,
I felt embarrassed for both of women.
This was beyond physical pain. This was emotional pain. Their pride was just left in that cell. Like, Mick Foley was right. It leaves you a shell of the person you used to be. You just didn't see it coming this way.
No, like, the hype for this match could not have been higher, and the end result could not have disappointed more.
They have three table spots that they fuck up, each of them. Two, technically.
Two table spots, one announced table spot. They didn't fuck up the announced table spot outside of the really, really fucking awkward. Sasha's way too high for Charlotte to get onto her shoulders, so she kind of had to make tippy toes.
Yeah. Like, but the tables that they brought in there were either not rigged to break, or Sasha was just too light, or Charlotte as well, I guess, too light to break them.
Yeah, like she near the end of the match, like. Sets up this table inside the middle of the ring, thinking, okay, something awesome's going to happen. They keep trying to tease it, but then we just wind up being cock-blocked over and over again because, you know, like, wrestling logic dictates that you need to give the audience what they want, just not when they want it.
Yeah.
Or not how they think they want it. What we want is one of those women to either powerbomb the other woman through the table or maybe do a flying elbow off the table, off the turnbuckle, right through the table, something, shatter that table, have impact. That doesn't happen because either the table wasn't rigged properly, gimmicked properly, or they just weren't used to tables and chairs, and they didn't know how to properly set them up or, you know, splash, you know, slam someone through the table to get that explosion and keep themselves safe.
Yeah,
they look so lost with these things inside.
Like inventing the wheel. It was sad. It was really sad.
It's like, here's how bad it got. Sasha reaches for a steel chair. At about the halfway mark, she doesn't swing that chair at Charlotte until about 25 minutes into the match. And it's the weakest chair shots I've ever seen. It's like this, like, she's she's gotten into the figure four, and she's got the chair, and she's trying to whap
the first,
Charlotte.
The first one is not even a shot. It's more of a dab.
It's a tap.
Like,
it's like a tap.
And then she has to, it's like she's trying to figure out how hard she should hit with it. And then the third one is like finally an actual hit.
Yeah, like there were, both women were so reticent about doing things to each other that it's immediately obvious that they didn't want to do it.
It's like they practiced this match, and I hope they did practice the match because it kind of didn't show. But it's like they practiced this match without actually using the props.
And that.
I don't know how wrestlers actually prepare for matches like this. If they actually throw themselves through tables to practice, I don't know.
Like, Edge went on record when during that whole big spot where he launches himself and spears Jeff Hardy while he was dangling with the belts at TLC 2. He was asked, like, how many times did you practice that, man? He's like, are you kidding me? I only did it once.
Yeah.
And, like, and from that perspective, like, it was a miracle that it wound up doing as good as it did.
Yeah.
Because, like, if you didn't practice that, and you did it, Jesus, fuck. But, so if that logic in mind, I guess they just didn't practice it. But, for fuck's sake. When something this heavily involved, you need to be comfortable in your environment. You know, I will say this. Seeing Charlotte, like, seeing Sasha basically bounce Charlotte's head off the steel chair was probably the lowest point of the entire night for me. Because, well, one, Charlotte's not short. Not like Sasha. So seeing Charlotte having to contort herself to get low enough to actually bounce her head off of the steel chair is bad enough. But then you realize, why is there a steel chair? Like, they do that all the goddamn time. They do that all the goddamn time. In regular matches, they bounce each other's heads off the announce table. Women do that all the time. Over, like, in turnbuckles and such. You're using a steel chair to do something you do all the time. Swing a chair. It's not that hard. Jim Cornette went on a countless tirade about how anyone could do hardcore wrestling because all they're doing when they're just taking shots with each other with using real pieces of lumber and real pieces of furniture. Anyone could do it, but apparently they couldn't. Not until like 25 minutes into the goddamn match. Instead, they had like this, again, going around the block to go next door to set up this one spot where it's basically a backbreaker over the steel chair. Plenty brutal. But why did we... It's not like it looks impressive. It would have been far more satisfying and gratifying to see Sasha or Charlotte pick up the steel chair. I'm not talking about a chair shot. I'm not talking a chair shot to the head.
You don't have to be fucking Jackie Chan with your environment here.
Yeah, I'm not talking about like that. Just like when the other person's down, just whap, whap, whap. It's not even that hard to do it safely.
You just take a lesson from, you know, Curtis Axel. He laid it out for you.
Yay! Yay! Yay!
Okay, I can't even do that and take it seriously. I can't even not take it seriously. But seriously, but yeah, the weakest point for me was the finish. The botched finish, and that's why I say three times the table, because she tries to break the table
with
a move that's not a move, that's not interesting in the first place. I was. Before she even got to the table, when I saw what she was doing, I was already upset because it wasn't a good move. It was just a toss. Just a sack toss.
It's like a hip toss.
Like, yeah, it was just like with this. It was the same thing you do pretty much when you throw a person back into the ring by their shorts, you know? It was just a Charlotte grabs Sasha and just kind of does a...
And then...
Push into the table. And I was like... Fuck, I guess at least if this ends the damn thing. But it doesn't. She doesn't break the table. Again. First it was Charlotte who didn't break the table down there.
No, she broke the table, but she did it in the most embarrassing way, where she just kind of nudged onto it, and then it just kind of crumbled underneath.
No, she didn't break the table part.
She didn't break the table. But she wound up being nudged onto the table, and the table kind of collapsed under her.
That's not breaking the table.
The table broke. That table broke, but it's...
The legs collapsed under it.
Yeah, that's...
When you break a table, you're supposed to crack the wood. That's why they would always call it "Get out, you know, get out the wood" for the Dudley Boys. It was about breaking the wood, not the frickin' legs underneath it.
I guess I missed that part, but yeah. Like,
that table wasn't broken. It wasn't cracked anywhere. It was just the legs. That's why Sasha Banks later on, or after the spot, gets out of the ring, and I think you might have been looking at the editing or something. At the
well, time. No, I was taking my notes.
Or taking notes, but was she? Yeah, you missed this point, I remember. But she picks up the table that's unbroken. You can see it's unbroken. Mm-hmm. And she kind of looks at it like this and just shoves it in, like, against the rope or the ring.
Like, she knows this match is going to shit.
And you can see in that look in her face when she just throws the fucking table like that. Like, she's just done, and she's just like, I'm so fucking pissed off right now.
Like, fucking,
and rightfully so.
I'm looking like a goddamn idiot. Yeah. I'm trying to do something for women, and this is what's happening.
And you know what? That look that she did, that little act right there, made me appreciate her.
Like, she didn't want this match to go to shit. Charlotte certainly didn't want this match to go to shit, but it did. You know, like, sometimes, you know, like, two great talents go inside a ring, and they can't polish a turd. The turd's too big.
But that little honest moment from Sasha, I appreciated that.
But, she tries to hip toss her into the table again, two times, couldn't break the table, and then Charlotte pins her for the win. 1, 2, 3.
I really thought that when I saw that look on her face and she threw that fucking table, I thought that she was ready to get serious. I thought they were both going to start just turning this around, but they didn't.
Like, it's like they got angry, but they just couldn't let the anger fly.
Yeah.
Like, both women wanted to protect the other woman, as every good wrestler wants to do. But they just couldn't trust their own ability to do what needs to be done safely. So they wind up doing it half-assedly. And that's, you know, when you're trying to sell the idea that women can be in hardcore matches like this, that's the last thing you want to do. Half-ass it.
You already had Charlotte do a springboard fucking moonsault to the outside of the ring from the top turnbuckle. That's more dangerous than, like, anything they did in this.
Yeah, like,
that was incredibly fucking risky.
Yeah, like, Charlotte is not somebody who's afraid to get themselves hurt by doing that. I think she was afraid of hurting Sasha too much. And, like, no wrestling school teaches wrestlers, especially female wrestlers, on how to do, like, backyard wrestling style wrestling. Like, here's how to safely do a chair shot, or this is how what you do to make sure that somebody doesn't die when you're launching yourself off from the top of a fucking steel cage.
And I am so fucking pissed off. I resent anyone who is going to go online and start saying this shit about how women can't be that aggressive. Women can't take that extra, go that extra mile and hurt someone. Don't you fucking say that. Don't you fucking say that. Because that is bullshit. That's not the problem. It's about getting used to the objects. It's about getting used to your environment. That's all it is.
Yeah, and both women looked completely out of their element.
Yeah.
Just absolutely out of their element. When they were back in their element, where they were just doing grappling and strike moves and having a wrestling match that just happens to be inside a Hell in a Cell, it was fine.
Yeah.
It wasn't going to bring the house down, but they knew that they couldn't go inside Hell in a Cell without, you know, breaking out the hardware. And they just couldn't handle it. And worst of all, though, what you were right in one area. The most embarrassing moment for me.
One area.
Like, you were, well, not just one area, but you were more right than I let on. Well, the most embarrassing moment for me was the, you know, like, bouncing Charlotte's head off the steel chair, wasting my goddamn time doing it, was the fact that they, once again, okay, as predictable as it would have been for Sasha to win, you know, hometown and everything, that's the only way this could have ended. Because otherwise, what you have done since July, we did the math on this, since July 25th, when Sasha Banks won the women's title from Charlotte on Raw, was that for the last 4 months, July, August, September, and October 25th, 4 months, you know, it's like August 25th, that's 1 month, September, October, 3 months, it wasn't June, either way. In a span of only, like, 3 or 4 months, you changed hands. You've hot potatoed this belt 4 times.
You talk about elevating the women's title belt, and you pass it back and forth like a ping pong ball.
Between these two women. like this, not even Lita and
Trish,
you know, ping ponged the women's title. Trish held it for a long time, and Lita, you know, was the heel in that recipe. But she didn't need the women's title to have heel heat or have momentum behind her. You don't need to, like, bounce this belt back and forth. And speaking of Trish, Trish took a bump.
Took a powerbomb through a table from Bubba Ray Dudley. Hell yeah, she did.
She did. That is, you know, like, not condoning man-on-woman violence in WWE, but from a pure...
point is, from an objective point of view, she took a fucking table. She took a table spot.
She took a fucking
table. And boy, was that off the top rope, too. It was a big one.
Mae Young took a table.
Yeah.
Mae Young.
Who was like 98 at the time.
Maybe not that much, but I'm going to be surprised. Like, sure, like, she was, you know...
I'm trying to be polite. I know she was probably 120, but...
Maybe you want to blame it on the fact that the tables weren't gimmicked properly. That might have been the case. But the issue still here is that use the force necessary.
Oh, God, I was going to say the force.
Yeah.
But yes.
No, but like you didn't use force necessary. We've seen Charlotte. We literally just saw Charlotte powerbomb Sasha through an announce table. We know she can do the powerbomb. We know that she could, you know, not only can Sasha take the powerbomb, but take it safely on the announcement.
Yeah, you set up this, you give us the opening, you expand our minds for those who needed it, that this can happen. You did it. And then you go on to show us that we were wrong, or that you, like, what the fuck? You go on to not deliver the rest of the match. It's really weird.
This, you know, this squeaky fart of a match that had all the momentum behind it, and you pissed your pants before the starting pistol even began.
I mean, Mick Foley's promo for this match was, God, that was big. That was really heated. That was a good promo.
I mean, you know, truth be told, like, we don't need Mick Foley kind of edging in on, you know, like, what should be their spotlight.
Hell no, but I felt that it was good, though. It was like in a way, it's like a passing of the torch to, you know, women's wrestling.
And that's fine, and that is readily acceptable, good, but to have all that, and then to have this afterward, I mean, I'm trying to wrap my head around people's excitement and thinking that it's match of the year candidate, and I'm thinking, well, the storytelling was so good. Excuse me, baking powder? What storytelling? Ripping off of King of the Ring 98 and brutalizing each other. Okay, when they're wrestling, yeah, they're brutalizing each other. Every time they're weapon... But the other half of that actual wrestling match we saw, where they're trying their damnedest to work with tables and chairs that they're not used to, and very awkwardly, obviously not used to... The only story they're telling me is that, oh my God, we're in over our heads. Like, oh my God, I hope I didn't just murder Charlotte, or oh my God, I hope I didn't murder Sasha.
Yeah.
That's the story that they're telling me. Now, you might think that, well, you know, like, the whole announce table spot was enough to, you know, to give them credit for, you know, for being hardcore, or at least modern WWE's version of hardcore, but I would say that even on its best day, like, even if you wanted to look at this match at the most positive of lights, this was a subpar hardcore match that got elevated to the point of absurdity. And from that perspective, I consider it the most disappointing match of the year.
When the most painful spot in the match is the wedgie you're getting from Charlotte.
Yeah. If you expect us to believe that Sasha Banks nearly broke her goddamn neck and or back, taking a powerbomb through an announce table. Fuck the fact that you don't see women do this after all that often. It's a powerbomb through an announce table. That's like saying, like, oh my god, I hurt my real back by having a Boston crab on me. I took a Boston crab and it really hurt my back, guys.
Well, to be fair, we don't really know exactly how much it really does hurt through that table. I suspect not that much, but...
I suspect not that much either, considering how often and how readily wrestlers take a trip to the table.
I mean, I think there's lots of cushions under that thing.
There might be lots of cushions, there might be... We don't know, but the point is, we've seen it over and over and over again, and we're supposed to believe that this somehow is enough to end the match? I'm not saying launch Sasha off the top of the
saying that women are these dainty little flowers, and then that's enough to do it for a woman, but not for a man, and fuck you.
Like, I mean, I'm
remember
not...
Remember the point of the match.
I'm not asking, again, not asking for Sasha to go over the fucking top of the fucking Hell in a Cell and actually do another Mick Foley. That's the last thing I want her to do. I'm thinking, don't castrate the match.
Yeah. It's just the spots that you have do well on. Deliver.
Get used to it.
If you've already opened up the fact, if you've already dedicated yourself to the fact that you're going to hit someone with a chair, you've accepted that. Hit them with the chair.
Trust your abilities.
Yeah.
You went to school and you trained for who knows how long to be able to protect yourself and the person in the ring. Trust your abilities to do that.
Yes. And if you don't feel like you can do it, then don't do it in the match. Don't do it. Do something else. Like, because a proper wrestling match would have been better than this.
Yeah, it would have been. I didn't think I would, like, looking back on my thoughts on Brock Lesnar versus Randy Orton at SummerSlam, I think I gave that match a little too much credence. You know, like, I considered it more weird than bad.
It was a beatdown. It was just Brock Lesnar doing what he does in UFC to Randy Orton, laying on top of you like a big old fucking Kodiak and just banging his wrists into your face and elbows.
Yeah, like, seeing a hard-way juice job like that in today's WWE was jarring, to say the least. But you know what? At the end of the day, it was a 10-minute match.
It wasn't even a match.
It was a 10-minute bout. It didn't waste my time for 30, 40 minutes on a thud of a, on what should have been, what was built up to be, a milestone of women's wrestling.
It was a letdown, but it wasn't embarrassing.
Mm-hmm. This was a letdown and an embarrassment.
Like, neither Brock nor Randy Orton, like, came out for the worse because of it, what they did?
I would argue Brock kind of did. Yeah, I mean, like, I think this match, that match really highlighted how much Brock kind of, like, his whole style of match, you know, suplex.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. By the end of that match, no one was having fun.
But I can guarantee you, I watched a match with him in UFC, and that's how he does it. So he just lays on top of you and beats you down.
You know what? Some, you know, like, that has its moments, and
gets the job done.
That has its moments. But at the very least, I could look at, you know, Brock Lesnar, Randy Orton as a 10-minute curiosity. At least it didn't overstay its welcome. Some might say that it did, but if it did, it only did it by like 5 or 6 minutes, not 30 minutes. This was embarrassing. This was disappointing. And I don't, like, some people are going to defend this purely on based on the fact that it's the first women's Hell in a Cell match. And because they were so hyped for it that they're able to buy what they were selling, even though what they were selling was mediocre, disappointing bullshit. And if you found yourself one of them, congratulations. I wish you the best on enjoying this match. I mean, I don't wish you the best. I mean, like, fine. Like, I'm glad you like this match. And I'm sorry that we weren't able to. But I can't look at this match as anything other than a low point for both women. I just can't. As bad as Natasha, like, when, as bad as Charlotte,
Sasha, or Charlotte.
No, like, as bad as when Charlotte was fighting Natalia was fighting Natalia during the earlier months when Sasha was on the mend, and just, like, and having this bullshit match after bullshit match after bullshit match, as bad as that was, at the very least, it didn't pretend to be anything other than, we're just killing time until Sasha comes back.
And it wasn't hyped.
It was not hyped.
This was so hyped. They did put it as the main event. So this was a twofer. It was not only the first woman's Hell in a Cell.
It was also
the first woman's match being a main event in a pay-per-view.
In a WWE pay-per-view.
They blew two fucking wads there, man. That's two things. And they didn't have to do that. They did not have to do that. They could have had this be a first of its kind and then dangle the first woman's main event later on for even more publicity, for more seats being filled. They could have capitalized on both of those separate events, but they did it in one. And when you do both of those in one, that's a huge motherfucker. That is big. That is a juggernaut, man.
This is, like, if you're going to be doing that match better be like a Stone Cold classic and leaving no doubts in anyone's mind. This had to have been Undertaker Shawn Michaels at WrestleMania 25.
Yeah.
This had to be Daniel Bryan, Batista. Well, some people didn't really like that match, but you know what I mean. Like, it had to have been, like, by far and away one of the best matches in WWE history to match the levels of hype that from both sides. And
guess what? It only had to be that good for a women's match. The bar is so low.
Even both women raising it as of late. Over the past few months, they have been raising the quality and standards.
Yeah, I mean, look at the way it used to be. You know, Attitude Era, Ruthless Aggression Era, even worse.
Yeah,
but look at the way it used to be. Beth Phoenix aside, perhaps, but
bra and panties matches all aside.
But you've carried it really high. But when it comes to backyard wrestling and stuff like that, like, the bar is just down there, not being used. Just pick the damn thing up and you got something, you know? Just pick the bar up and hit someone with it.
I'm spent.
Yeah, I was spent before this review. I just... The only thing, getting me through doing this right now is that I needed to vent. And getting through the matches up to this one has just been kind of waiting to say this. I just am so... I'm so let down. I'm so let down.
No one, even if you liked the match, you hated the ending. So no matter what, this pay-per-view ended on a fucking thud.
And I really hope that this doesn't put a bar on future possibilities for women's matches. I really, really hope it doesn't. Because at the very least, nobody was, like, critically injured because of, being unprepared or whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
There was no, like, oh, you weren't ready for this and you killed someone, you know?
It's not like Charlotte opened her up hard way, you know? Just like...
Yeah. It's not like that happened. So there's no reason to say, oh, no, women are not safe to be doing this kind of stuff or anything like that. Because guess what? They clearly are. Because look at how safe this match was.
But also pay attention to how thoroughly unwatchable it is, too. Especially if you're not used to it. I think we're just spinning in circles, so I think we need to end this now and just clear out the ether, as it were.
Yeah, I'm sorry for, some of the repetitiveness we might have had, but... It's so glaringly... Just... It's so in the forefront of our minds right now, we just can't shake it.
Yeah. So, next is Survivor Series. And that won't be until Thanksgiving weekend, so we won't be... you won't be getting any new Kevin Nash merchandise for a while.
Oh, fucking God, thank you. Small fucking mercies.
Small miracles.
Yeah.
Till next time.